The way we're going to do this is Vaidhi will do a 10-minute summary of what he thinks the book is about. I'll do a 5-minute kind of response. Then we will have a conversation. And then finally, Vaidhi will throw it open to the audience for questions. Vaidhi. By the way, it's just as a matter of curiosity, I've known Vaidhi since 1967. We have been classmates in college from then, so this is a repeat. And my last book also, when it was released in Bangalore at Crossword, Vaidhi was part of the panel. Vaidhi, over to you.
So thank you, Jaithirth. Very, as he told initial my disclaimer, I knew him from school days. We belong to the same area, actually, so long time, actually, and in spite of it, he has kept he's very rigor and vigor still. And his book is he mentioned about 10 minutes, it's not adequate because literally every page has to be read. Actually, I'm seriously telling, it's a very important book. If I could think of 2019 non-fiction major book from India, I would strongly recommend this book only. It's something which is extremely important from the point of view of first time it is presenting what you may loosely call the, I would not use the word alternate, what one can call arguments or ideas, because this is actually the main ideas. The left ideas are the alternate, and because we have become so, funnily perverted. We talk about Ayurveda as alternate. Ayurveda is not alternate. Allopathy is alternate. So, but anyhow, this is how the, this is what I call the terminological terrorism, that part. And as he was mentioning, some of my books are also outside. Kindly buy them. And in my case, just if you buy, it's enough for me. You don't have to read it. And in Jerry's case, you must read it. Whether every page you must read it. So the objectives are, because I can't ask my students to read my books or anything read for that matter. They will take me to Human Rights Commission and other thing. Because reading is considered as a major harassment by students nowadays. So why are you asking us to read, sir? Other than what comes in WhatsApp, I don't think they read anything more than that, actually. But they are like that, right? So coming to this fascinating book, actually. The title of the book, I am sure you would be able to, it is Indian Conservative. It's not conservative Indian. But the first time a book of this nature has come out, which also explicitly argues and weaves the argument that the what is called Hindu nationalist ideas. Of course, some people will call it fringe element. Some people will call it as the demagogues, or various types of names are there. The Hindu nationalist ideas are also, to a large extent, can be considered as part of the subset of this conservative, Indian conservative, or as an intersecting. People who are familiar with the Venn diagram would know it could be partly intersecting part of the theme. The book is divided into political, social, aesthetics, cultural, as well as
economic.
So very different, but there is a extraordinarily interesting introductory chapter that covers the whole spectrum in a very subtle fashion. And something you should know is there is an extraordinary amount of breadth of information and depth. He talks about Edmund Burke and the Scottish economist, father of economic Adam Smith on one side, and then the Apastamba Sustra and our own Shanti Parvas and Tirukkural. He actually takes Shanti Parva and Tirukkural as one of the two major contributory elements in the conservative pantheon of Indian thinking. He brings later into the issue of Raja Ram Mohan Rai and our Bankim Chandra Chatterjee. And somewhere along the line, very fascinating, he says, Hindu Mahasabha, for instance, was headed by our founder. He was also later founder of Bharatiya Jansangh. He was actually more a moderate compared to Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose, who could be easily considered as a not a moderate or anything. But Bose was elected twice by the Congress party as Congress president, even though, you know, Gandhi in his own what one can call methods of trickery or whatever you call it, he did not allow Bose to continue as president. What he wants to say is the traditional thinking is Hindu Mahasabha is something called extremist or not a moderate, while as Congress is. But actually, it is the Congress representatives who elected Bose who can be termed more as a extremist rather than Hindu Mahasabha. Like that, you know, there are so many type of new ways of looking at things. One of the areas, two of the areas only I would like to briefly mention. One area is the hijacking of the entire education field in India. The post-60s, more so post-50s itself. Out of that, partly our economic thinking also. What I would rather, he has not termed it, I would rather term it as Nehruvian Stalinist, you know, who have literally actually taken over the education field. I had occasion to listen to Nooral Hassan in the early 70s, who came to Calcutta. I studied at Calcutta best part of my life under all possible, you know, what one can call Marxist, Naxalite, moderate Marxist, moderate Naxalite, extreme Naxalite. All of them were my good teachers, right? So Nooral Hassan came and explained to us about starting some 10 centers all over India about, Hyderabad, Trivandrum, Chennai, Delhi. And he told that over a period of 15, 20 years, we would be able to generate a significant number of young scholars in Marxian thinking who will dominate our entire academic field. He was not very far from truth, actually, coming to think of it. Today, even if you want to replace some of them, it is very difficult. It is very difficult to get people who are conservative in thinking or alternate thinking. Or today, intellectual mean you have to be a leftist and you have to get a chapa from those, Nehruvian Stalinist. There is no other way, actually. If you want to do research in social science, you have to undertake in the Marxian paradigm or Marxian scheme of thing. Anyhow, he has elaborated this. This is an extraordinarily dangerous type of situation which got developed over a period of time. The second thing is, which is a subsect of the education thing, is the AIT. You know, the Aryan invasion was propagated by the, like nobody's business actually, throughout the period. And as he rightly says, Caldwell could be considered as the father of this whole thing. And even when it was, facts came, you know, floating, R.S. Sharma's and Romila Thapar's were not very enthusiastic. They shifted from Aryan invasion, it could be possibly Aryan migration. And later they slowly shifted Aryan tourism, you know, various, phenomenal type of fudging of the whole thing. Throughout something like 40, 50 years, originally it was felt by some of the people in the Indira Gandhi thing that, you know, the JNU type of thing will be a sort of a closeted community and, you know, let all these people make noises inside so that the pressure cooker can be in a particular place bursting. They didn't understand how it could have a devastating impact. What is the end impact of it? Consequential, you'll be shocked actually. You might have heard about Srinivas and Ramanujam, I'm sure. One of the great mathematicians of our time. Like my American professor says, you are really a dumbest civilization in the world. In our country, we would have had at least 10 scientific research centers all over USA named after Ramanujam. We don't even have one, actually. More interesting part of it is, he lived in a town called Kumbakonam, which is not very far from here, actually. There is a lane where he lived. The lane may be of this length, this whole auditorium length only. It's a small lane. Somebody wanted to name it as Ramanujam Lane. You know, in Tamil Nadu, it's very popular to name, you know, why in Tamil Nadu, all over India, actually. Everybody wants to be, you know, we have I did some independent research some other time. 850 major projects, airports, roads, everything named after three members of a family. You know who are the family members, right? 850. Other than that, I was told by Surya Prakash, who is heading the Prasar Bharati, there are 1700 minor schemes which are also named. This is actually worse than the North Korean situation. Kim had actually something like 550 only. It's a small country. We have 850. This Ramanujam lane could not be named, sir. Can you beat that? Because everybody told he is a descendant of that AIT. Even today, it cannot be named there. His house is there, today taken out, taken care by a private university, Sastra University, who just maintained that. Otherwise, no. This is the one of the consequences of this pernicious doctrine which was spread. The last point he talks about, very, very interesting point, is the issue of corruption. How this entire socialist aspect of the economy, the methods of control by the government, has poisoned the whole system. Ease of doing business, we talk about SEBI and we talk about reforms in RBA. Nobody talks about Shops and Establishment Act. Nobody talks about Food and Adulteration Act. Food and Adulteration Act is one of the draconian act. And the small mercies, I thank my God, it's not covering our individual household kitchens. Otherwise, that inspector will come and say, your cooker is not in good shape to my wife, and we have to break. All this, every act, regulation by the government is a mechanism to extort money from ordinary citizens. Take it from me. There is nothing about, whenever somebody is talking about strengthening regulation, mean more bribe should be, we have to modify regulation, mean modify methods. So he has extensively dealt with that aspect also. Food and adulteration, why I remembered, last week I had a conversation with one of the small restaurant person near my home. Every week that fellow comes and he has to be given some envelope. Right? So I asked, why don't you all fight it out? In the sense, we talk about the majesty of law and take them to court. He is from a town called Udupi, where from quite a knowledgeable, and he also comes from nearby place, I think. He told me a very interesting thing. Professor, you should know, in our town, there is a story. One buffalo was running very fast on the road, madly on the road. And everybody was running helter-skelter. And one elephant, which has come out of the forest nearby, it was standing there, and it stopped the buffalo. Why are you running like this, madly? Buffalo told, no, you see, the new government has come. They are arresting all the cows. Why? They feel the cows are the real root cause of problems in India. Because every day in the TV debate, cows come, lynching come, cow smuggling and all. Cow has become a botheration. So the government felt better to arrest all the cows. And then the elephant asked, but you are a buffalo. Why are you worried? Buffalo told, that's true, but it will take 25 years to prove it in an Indian court that I am a buffalo, not a cow. So the elephant started running. So that is the type of a situation where this draconian regulatory framework has landed us in. So he covered, the canvas is so large, you would be fascinated to look at the book, go through that, absorb it. I went through it twice, actually. It's very, very important and interesting book, which first of its kind, if I understand correctly, which incorporates aspects of the Hindu nationalism as also one of the dimensions of Indian conservatism. The only question you may be having is, why it is Indian conservative or not conservative Indian? It could have been, he puts it. So we will leave it at that, and then let the author comes forward. We have the ex-chief secretary of Karnataka government here, but I'm sure he will take it in the correct spirit when we are talking about government regulation and other things. Right? Okay. Thank you.
He doesn't have a choice, does he? Thank you, Vaidhi. Basically, the book came out of a series of lectures that I gave at Ashoka University, and it came from the very reason that Vaidhi mentioned. I have been concerned now for many years that Indian academia, as well as academics in North America and in Europe who study India, that entire range of all those institutions are dominated by Marxists, Freudians, and postmodernists, all of whom, in my humble opinion, are charlatans of the worst kind. But they dominate it, and as a result, over the last 20, 30, 40 years, all the PhDs who've come out on Indian studies, studying Indian sociology, anthropology, history, literature, whatever, end up looking at the world through the Marxist, Freudian, or postmodernist lenses. And it's very difficult today to replace them. That's why this government, when it tries to replace them, they go and score self goals by appointing weird people who think that Rama used to fly in a plane and so on. Because you're not able to find scholars. That has been the level of domination. And certainly Indira Gandhi and Nurul Hasan did it consciously in India. I think Indira's plan was very simple. In 1968, after the Berkeley riots, the Paris riots, she was genuinely concerned that there would be a leftist movement in India. So she said the best thing is to give these jobs, these guys jobs in JNU and in some center in Calcutta and in Madras and Trivandrum, and let them drink their tea and let them go on trips to Moscow and Leningrad, which is what it was called those days, and we will keep them tamed and house trained. But of course, the consequences were not that simple. They produced PhDs and they made sure that only their type got promoted, got tenure, etc. So we really have a problem. So I told Rudrangshu Mukherjee, the Chancellor of Ashoka, I said, you're trying to be a new liberal arts college. I want to come and give your students an alternate point of view. Because nobody teaches Burke or Hume. And if you do mention Shantiparva or Tirukkural, then you're a reactionary in any of your universities. So I want to give that point of view. And he encouraged me. I gave a series of lectures, and that got converted into a book. He introduced me to this young lady, Sarkar, who, the juggernaut, the publisher, and they very quickly came out with the book. So this is the origin of the book. It deals with conservatism, Indian conservatism, in five sections: economic, political, cultural, social, and aesthetic and education, aesthetics and education. It argues that while modern conservatism as we know it starts with Edmund Burke, Reflections on the French Revolution, actually there is an Indic conservative tradition going back to the Shantiparva of the Mahabharata, going back to the Tirukkural, going back to the Apasambha Sutra of the Ajurveda. And it's amazing human synchronicity, or whatever you want to call it, that the ideas of Burke and Hume and Adam Smith find so many parallels in these texts. Kautilya, I'm not so sure he was a conservative. He certainly had certain conservative aspects. He did not want a large bureaucracy. Kautilya was very clear about certain things. He said, the more officials you appoint, the more officials the king appoints, the more corruption there will be, and the more persecution of citizens there will be. So he wanted to a minimalist state. But apart from that, I think Kautilya was a little too amoral to be considered in the same league as a Tiruvalluvar or the author of the Shantiparva. Anyway, modern conservatism is really Anglo-Saxon. In the continent, they are given to idealism. They're not given to empiricism the way the Anglo-Saxons are, and therefore they, you know, Rousseau's Noble Savage and so on, they always have this idealized view of primitive man, whereas Hobbes has a very clear view that primitive man was savage and brutish, and it's only civilization which has made modern human beings less savage and less brutish. And across the Atlantic, you have Hamilton, you have the Federalist Papers, and parts of Jefferson. So essentially, it's an Anglo-Saxon phenomenon, Burke, Hume, Smith, Locke and Hobbes a little bit, and there it's Hamilton, Jay, and so on. In India, modern conservatism starts with two seminal figures, Ram Mohan Roy and Bankim, both Bengalis, both 19th century intellectuals, part of the great Bengal Renaissance. The interesting thing is both of them wanted British rule to continue for a long time. So in India, the pre-independence conservative movement, particularly in the political side, had a lot of people who thought British rule was good. In fact, Ram Mohan Roy told this visiting French aristocrat, "I want British rule to continue for a long time in India so that we can gain more from it." Bankim ends his Anandamat saying British rule is providential for India. So what has happened post-independence is all these figures, be it a Bhandarkar, be it any Jadunath Sarkar, be it any of these people, Shankaran Nair, who had a nuanced, Tej Bahadur Sapru, who had a nuanced view of British rule and who wanted the British connection to continue, they have all been discarded as collaborators, traitors, etc. And therefore, they are dismissed in the post-1947 discourse. And that has given conservatism itself a bad name. And let us think of some. He mentioned specifically Shyam Prasad. Shyam Prasad's letter to the Viceroy is quite clear. If the Japanese invade India, and they will come through Bengal, presumably, we will resist. So who is the anti-fascist? Who is the anti-Nazi? And who shook hands with Hitler, Tojo, and Mussolini? So, if you look at the reality, and yet Shyam Prasad today is dismissed as a collaborator because he even collaborated with the Muslim League, but he's dismissed as somebody who was anti-Muslim, which he was not. He was in a Muslim League cabinet in Bengal. So the idea that some of these people should be dismissed and their intellectual contribution not taken seriously. And even within the Congress, if you think about it, there was always a conservative caucus. Rajendra Prasad, Patel, Munshi represented a conservative caucus. And Rajagopalachari opposed the Quit India movement. He quit the Congress. Does it make him a traitor? Does it mean that only those who support Quit India movement, are patriots? I think that problem we have to get over. We have to get over this phobia with the Raj if we have to revisit Indian conservatism. I have quoted from an 1895 speech at the Indian Social Congress by Bhandarkar, where he actually explicitly says, we should follow British traditions. We should not imitate the French Revolution. We should have continuity in our processes. We should have conservatism, and we should not do revolutionary things. And I consider that the high watermark of Indian conservative political thought. On the economic side, clearly Nauroji and Dutt were both conservatives in the sense they opposed company and British rule, not because it was defending free trade or laissez-faire, but in fact it was getting the exchange rate and the tariffs to the detriment of Indian entrepreneurs. They called for a level playing field. They did not call for special benefits to the public sector or to the crony capital sector. They wanted a level playing field. Post-independence, the greatest name is B.R. Shenoy. Shenoy got marginalized. He was kicked out of Delhi by Mahalanobis and his people, and the rest is tragic history. Korea, Taiwan, and subsequently China went ahead. China, we were richer than China as recently as 1962. It's just absurd how much we've conceded by a post-Avadi resolution. That's on the economic side. On the cultural side, the real problem with these Marxist and postmodernist academics is that they have bought into the European Orientalist vision of India, that there was no India before the British came. India is purely a map on lines on a map. It's a civic state, citizenship, nationality. Everything comes from purely constitutional secular laws. There's nothing else. There is no such thing as an idea of India. And this is pretty much what the British believed, that there was no India. Madrasis and Punjabis and Bengalis were not one country. But I argue very strongly that that is not the case. Benedict Anderson is a famous American political scientist who's talked about imagined nations and imagined communities, that India was imagined a long time ago the way it is. And actually, the best writer about this is Radha Kumud Mukherjee. Has again forgotten there is no history department anywhere in any university or college in India which will teach you Jadunath Sarkar, Radha Kumud Mukherjee, or Nilakantha Shastri. They're all banned. It is some Bipin Chandra and some vague, mediocre people who are forced on our students. And Radha Kumud Mukherjee talks about India being a land of pilgrims and pilgrimages. And you know, and I argue that this is not just a Hindu issue. There's a Muslim Sufi pilgrimage circuit in India, starting from Delhi to Ajmer to Ahmedabad to Bombay to Gulbarga, all the way south to Nagpur, back north through Kadapa, back to Bihar Sharif, back through Fatehpur Sikri, back to Delhi. India is the only country where there is a Sufi pilgrimage circuit within a country. It doesn't exist elsewhere. The Sikhs have a pilgrimage circuit, the Jains have. So this idea that it's a purely Hindu thing is not true. I think the idea of Bharatavarsha being sacred, of the land as being sacred, even if you change the name to Hind, doesn't go away. It remains that way. And I've argued very strongly against this imposition of the idea that India is purely a civic state. It's not. It's a sacred, imagined entity. And that's the way it has been, and that's the way I believe it continues to this day. The social one is the most difficult for conservatives because generally, you know, caste, oppression of women, etc., are issues that are difficult to say, hey, the old is good. And here I have, you know, taken recourse to certain very important conservative principles. In fact, Burke argues, and Scruton repeatedly quotes Burke, that conservatives need to change. We're not opposed to change. In order to preserve the best of the past, we need to change. And Disraeli, the great conservative statesman of the 19th century, actually says in one of his novels, conservatism doesn't mean that you are conserving the worst aspects of the past. You're trying to preserve the best aspects of the past. So the idea that change conservatives are opposed to is a very simplistic idea. And they have a lot of tricks in their back. Rajaram Mohan Roy basically supported the abolition of sati by playing a trick. He just said the ancient scriptures don't sanction sati. It's only recent scriptures that you guys have written that sanction sati. So it's a trick, but it's a very clever trick. And it is a way to make sure that while abandoning sati, you don't abandon other aspects of Indian culture. And that's the interesting way that the social stuff, and I am much more sanguine on the way Indian society has progressed, be it on gender, be it on caste, be it on a variety of matters, and even on religious stuff. And I'll give you the example of Muslims, because they are always accused of being caught up in a ghetto and they are not progressing and so on. And I argue that's not true. It depends on how you want to position the story. There's a lady called Salma who writes in Tamil poetry, who's a Muslim feminist poet. Not known. Not important. There are movements, the entire movement to get women into the Haji Ali Dargah was led by Muslim women. So the idea that there are no stirrings, there is a Pasmanda Muslim movement in Bihar, which is about Muslims who converted from OBC castes. So in some sense, they are accepting that they are converts and their origin is Hindu, which is what the BJP would like, the RSS would like them to do. So there's all of these things are happening on the social side. And I think I am reasonably, I end the social side with a fair amount of optimism, if you will. One aspect that Vaidhi didn't cover, I'll just spend 1 minute and I'll stop, because otherwise, as you can see, when I start, I can get very enthusiastic and carried away. Failure in architecture. Complete failure in architecture. The whole country is saddled with public buildings in the PWD architecture style. And our new cities, Chandigarh is ridiculous. It's a totalitarian fiasco. Gandhinagar is boring. Naya Raipur is a ghost town. You know, we just, Amaravati, I know, up and down, I don't know where it's going to go. Navi Mumbai is just dismal. So we just are not getting our act together here. Of all of the new ones, Bhubaneswar actually is about the most reasonable, because I think the combination of the old and new in Bhubaneswar hasn't been done too badly. But in general, it's been a dismal scene, and we've neglected all our Raj buildings. It's only in the last 10, 15 years I notice that there is some attempt to refurbish. We keep changing their names. VT is called CST and so on. But at least VT station is getting refurbished. Prince of Wales Museum is getting refurbished. We are revisiting our Raj legacy a little bit. Not as much as we should. But architecture has been a fail from a conservative point of view. Music has been a great success. And although I am generally throughout the book arguing for the minimalist state, because Thiruvalluvar clearly did not want a strong monarch. He wanted a minimalist state. His hero was a plowman and the merchant, not the king. But there have been aspects of state intervention in the arts which have been good. All India Radio has been responsible for so much of Indian classical music, both Hindustani and Carnatic, getting to the levels it has. Today, of course, they are very strong and very vibrant. You just have to go to YouTube to figure that out. And we have invented a whole new kind of music which the rest of the world doesn't have, where our actors lip sync on the stage, on the screen, and there's a playback singer. Nobody else has this. And we have some of the finest music, be it Naushad, Vishwanathan Ramamurthy, Rahman, it doesn't matter who, Salil Chaudhary, S.T. Burman. I've quoted from S.T. Burman because S.T. Burman was a very great thinker. He was not just a music composer, he was an aesthetician. In one of his speeches, he says, the trick really is to get the right combination of classical music and folk music, both of which we have in abundance in our country. And I think music and dance particularly, I'm quite sanguine about. I think every conservative should be delighted, particularly in contrast to England, where Roger Scruton keeps complaining that church music is dying, nobody's going to church, nobody even knows how to play the organ. I mean, that's not happening here. We'll stop there. I think the idea is that there is in the political, because that's what most people are interested in, there is a continuous stream from Raja Ram Mohan Roy down to Rajagopalachari and Minu Masani, which I would call mainstream Burkean conservatism. There's another stream from Bankim Chandra Chatterjee through Lajpat Rai down to Deen Dayal Upadhyay, which I would call Hindu nationalism. And I am arguing that these are either siblings or they are at least ones that are overlapping. I have pointed out, at least on three occasions in the book, that there is a danger with Hindu nationalism, like with all nationalisms. We have seen the civilized country of Germany between 1933 and 1945, how pathological extremes of nationalism can create disasters for those societies. And there is that danger with Hindu nationalism also. But the moderate form of Hindu nationalism, I believe, is a legitimate subset of conservatism in the political sphere, because that's where most of the discussion goes. I wish it wouldn't. I wish a lot of the discussion would be on economics and culture. But in general, we are a political people, and right now, particularly the political action is so vivid and so vigorous, that's where the discussion goes. And I think there is also a lot in the book as a lament for the death of the Swatantra Party. In fact, you could read large sections of the book as just as that, as a lament for that. And I've argued that it cannot be revived. that under modern democratic politics, the issues of identity, be it caste or, you know, if it's a Wakkaliga identity, Lingayat identity, Maratha identity, Jat identity, or Dravidian or you know, Oriya nationalism, sub-nationalism, or religious, is going to dominate, and economics and free trade and free enterprise and issues like that are going to remain peripheral in the voters' minds. Therefore, what I have suggested is what I call the Rajni Kothari strategy. Rajni Kothari was a brilliant political scientist of the 50s and 60s who argued that the way the communists controlled the Congress Party was by infiltrating the Congress Party and by having caucuses within the Congress Party. The same was done by the Hindu nationalists. They would have K.M. Munshi within the Congress Party who would be part of their caucus. So different groups in India would infiltrate through their caucuses, and I have recommended that those of us who are of the conservative persuasion should try to infiltrate not just BJP and Congress, but also Trinamool, also NCP, and see how we can move them in the conservative direction using this Rajni Kothari strategy. That's on the political side where most of the interest is. I will stop there, and Vaidhi, go ahead, ask me questions, and I'm happy to answer them.
Yeah, thank you very much, Jerry. One aspect I thought I should highlight, you have mentioned that our India didn't start on 1947, August 15th or anything like that. We have been there for a long period of civilization. And you have touched upon the sacred elements of this entire ethos for a very long period of time. Actually, I always thought sacred should be the opposite of secular. But the communists have hijacked the whole debate and made communal as opposite of secular. It should have been actually sacred versus secular. And for us, everything is sacred, actually. Animals are sacred. India is the only country, I've traveled all over the world, I find women worshipping trees in the roads. I have never seen anywhere in the West or anywhere in US or anywhere. Couple of women suddenly will be around a tree. I do not know what type of tree it is, but they will be showing aarti, and they treat the tree as something like sacred. So we have always been having. So how did this whole debate became sacred and communal versus sacred and secular? To the extent I find secular was the original meaning was separation of church
that
and
which
the
is
state.
Not.
And so All India Catholic Council in India wants secularism to be strengthened. Indian Union Muslim League also wants secularism to be. So over a period of time, we have associated secularism to these minority or whatever you call different type of religious thing. It's not anymore versus sacred versus secular. It is communal versus secular. How this whole debate got twisted by the communists?
I think this is an excessive. See, what has happened, this has happened in the West too. In a standard American or European university today, Shakespeare and T.S. Eliot are dismissed as dead white males. You have to spend your time reading some African American poets or some Central American, Native American writers. That is the politically correct thing to do. So the entire Western canon, of which, of course, T.S. Eliot, the great conservative, represented it. I mean, in an Eliot poem, there will be quotations from Tristram and Isolde, quotations from Dante, quotations from Shakespeare. I mean, the works. So Eliot is dismissed. And this newfound thing, in a sense, a very similar political hijacking. Because if you read their so-called gurus, I mean, Nehru was profoundly, I've quoted him in a couple of places, profoundly influenced by the sacred. He wanted his ashes to be thrown into the Sangam. So the idea that the sense of the sacred was not there across the spectrum. I'm saying across the spectrum. I repeat this. There is a Jain pilgrimage circuit from Shravana Belagola to Bihar, Jharkhand, Rajasthan, Gujarat, Saurashtra. So the it is not a Hindu thing, but it has become viewed that way. That creates a problem. And we have bought into this. A lot of this comes from America and to some extent from SOAS in London and from Oxbridge. Wendy Doniger, for instance, was a very well-known scholar and a very powerful scholar. And all of her PhD students occupy extremely important positions in academia. She argues that the Hindus never attached any importance to Bhagavad Gita before 1850. Only after 1850 we started taking the Bhagavad Gita seriously because we wanted to impress the British that we too had a sacred book like the Bible. You know, I have argued this is patently not true. In 700 AD, Shankara wrote a commentary on the Bhagavad Gita when it was considered part of the Vedantic Prasthanatraya. So it's not true. We've always had a great centrality, at least within Vedanta, for the Bhagavad Gita. In Sankhya too, there's all Sankhya Yoga chapter. So this business that it's a newfound thing, everything that we do, according to these scholars, is simply a Hindu reaction, an Indian broadly, and more specifically a Hindu reaction to Western conquest and our inferiority complex and our need to prove something. The Dravidian thing you said, you know, before Caldwell wrote his book on the Dravidian languages, there is not one mention going back several thousand years of a Dravidian race. Dravida is a direction. It's a southern direction, that's what it. Dravidian race is this Christian missionary, Protestant missionary in Tirunelveli district who writes, and now it is part of the... See, these ideas and this is what has happened in this, in terms of this hijacking. It's really unnecessary because even Maulana Azad, in some of his best speeches, talks about the sacred nature of the Indian soil. You know, but it's now dismissed as something atavistic or reactionary to say that. And certainly it's not cool in modern universities, either in the West or in India. I have repeatedly quoted Masthi Venkatesh Iyengar, easily one of the greatest writers of the 20th century that our country has produced. And he describes India as Bahuratna Vasundara. India, which is a kind of earth studded with many gems. And Vasundhara, as you pointed out, is one of Lakshmi's names. It's the earth goddess. Prithvi Sukta of the Atharva Veda is about Vasundhara. So it's a recurring concept. And it doesn't go away. And certainly, whatever the elite may say, if you look at popular Indian art, it hasn't gone away. You go to the Bhopal Museum of Tribal Art and look at what modern tribal art is producing. It is very much in sync with the sacred. Does that answer your question? You've got it there.
Yeah.
You've got it here, right here.
Yes. Okay, only two pending thing I wanted to ask. Most of these, the Marxist, they take the English language to be the be-all and end-all. You know, Sanskrit, Tamil had a phenomenal amount of, for instance, a simple thing like our Sankalpa, you know, Bharat Varshe, Bharatagande, which we have been chanting for the last 1230, more than that, number of years, is never thought about as, is dismissed. So that is one problem I find is the communist Marxist, they think that English language is the only one. But much before that, you know, we had Nayan Mars. You have quoted extensively of Thiruvalluvar and Sanskrit literature. The only one point is here, you mentioned, of course, it is, I think, your son's contribution. Conservatism is opposed to a universalist ideology, even as its impulse is universal. You know, could you elaborate in the sense, because contemporarily everybody is talking about, you know, globalization and all over the world, everybody should be same. Like my girl student, buy the jeans and then buy a scissors.
Who are the two people we dislike most, Vaidhi?
Huh?
We dislike Rousseau because he thought of the noble savage kind of being across the planet. And we dislike Marx because he asked the workers of the world to unite. We just don't believe in this world unity business. Conservatism is a local phenomenon. It is, in fact, I keep repeatedly talking, we like clubs, we like Sangeeta Sabhas, Bhajan Mandalis, we like small civic Bangalore International Center. It's a Bangalore center. It has no pretensions to being a New York center and shouldn't be. So we are for but this impulse, I believe, exists in every country. And I've talked about this in one particular context. If we don't create these institutions, we run major risks. The best example is the difference between the French aristocracy and the English aristocracy. The English aristocracy played cricket with their gardeners and ordinary policemen and bakers. They would also play, and the lord and would also play cricket. Cricket became a unifying force across classes. The French dukes would never have agreed to play with the Third Estate. And you know, they had their heads chopped off. Whereas England managed to create a more balanced, harmonious society. Cricket, by the way, has been for India a very important lubricant. And I talk, there is a whole few pages on cricket as there is on Hindi film music. Indian film music, not just Hindi film music. And so I think institutions that bring people together are voluntary institutions, not state-sponsored ones, are very important, and this is what conservatives like. When de Tocqueville went to America, the thing that he noticed that really struck him was the town meetings in New England towns, where the entire town would come together in small towns in Vermont, Massachusetts, New Hampshire. And they would, to this day, by the way, I don't know how many of you know, almost 3/4 of the fire brigades in America are all volunteer fire brigades. They're not paid. There are local people who volunteer, go and sit at the fire station all day, all night. And they'll go, if there's a fire, they'll go and put it out, drive the fire engine, they're trained. They're volunteers, they're not paid. They're part of a voluntary association. So we don't like this, let us have one common Soviet model for the whole world, one planning commission for all of India. Anything that is globalist, that suggests that there are universal solutions to the problems of the human predicament, we're very skeptical. Having said that, not denying that in some localized solutions, in countries like Germany, they can become pathological. And in India too, if we are not careful, they can become pathological. In this town, during the anti-Kaveri riots, for 2 months, all Tamilians were denied Tamil shows on their TV channels. Not that long ago, 30 years ago, 25 years ago. So the othering, the way the Assamese today seem to other the Bengalis, the othering is a danger. And certainly, if the Hindu nationalists decide to other the Muslims, that will backfire. And I have argued that will be to explain it to them, the best way is to tell them it's like a Bhasmasura. Bhasmasura in the myth, finally he has this thing, magical power, to put his hand over somebody and that person gets burnt. And finally, in some mistaken thing, he puts it over his own head and burns himself. So that's what happened in Nazi Germany. That's what happened in militaristic Japan. Finally, they got Hiroshima and Nagasaki after going to extremes of pathological nationalism. That's a danger we have to be careful of. But because we have to be careful of that danger, doesn't we become rootless and we lose the sacred? Because if we do, then life is not worth living. And that's the real balance that we should try and strive to strike.
Before we open it to the audience,
damn it. Property rights, this is mine.
That's your, sure. One last, you know, you have mentioned about, toward the end, about this, the same thing what you were mentioning, the othering, you know, the what's popularly called, what is that called? Ganga Yamuna Tesip, you know, like unity. And you have given a lot of examples in terms of A.R. Rahman's and our various type of people, you know, art, literature, music, who have done extremely well, even though they belong to the Islamic tradition. I always used to wonder, maybe you could have an answer for this. There is no counterexample given. There is nobody is told that, you know, he is a great Hindustani musician or Bharatanatyam dancer who played in the Juma Masjid at Delhi or, you know, at the great cathedral at Goa or something. Maybe I am not well read in this. It's only one side it is told, you know, that some of the Islamists have done extremely well in terms of music. In Bollywood, of course, everybody knows about it.
But no, I think you're mistaken there. I think there, if you, you know,
good counterexamples.
Qawwali, which is done in all Sufi dargahs in India only, by the way, and maybe in Pakistan, in Sufi dargahs, is an Indian art form. Or you could even say it's a Hindu art form, which has been borrowed by the Sufis extensively in India. So it's not true. And the most Hindu scholars were scholars of Persian. I don't think there were too many Hindu scholars of Arabic, because the Islamic encounter with India largely took place through the Persian language and less through the Arabic language. And therefore, you find a lot of Hindu scholars who wrote in Persian, but you don't find, and of course, in the late 19th and early 20th century, wrote in Urdu, like Premchand and so on. So that is, it's not true. I mean, there have been contributions on both sides. The ones that interest me most, really, is Sheikh Chinna Maulana playing the Nadaswaram. You know, it's kind of interesting. Chakkani Rajamargamu, which is a very important composition he plays. And you can see these kinds of things. Music particularly, music and cricket to some extent have been leavening features in the evolution of modern Indian political and social consciousness. And we should be I have again quoted my favorite writer, Ashish Nandi, who, speaking ex cathedra, authoritatively says, cricket is an Indian game which was only accidentally invented by the English. So it and so it's there is that whole aspect of the way. And I'm hoping that we will be able to move the dialogue going forward into a greater level of optimism, a greater level of pride, not necessarily arrogance or conceit, but kind of a quiet pride that this is an endeavor that we cannot accept the Orientalist. I mean, according to them, when was the Regulating Act? Was 1778 or 1778, I think. That was when the governors of Madras and Bombay were asked to report not to London, but to the governor of Bengal, who was made governor general. So Indian unity starts with 1778, Regulating Act of 1778. I mean, this is okay, and then at one level, I'm not denying that administrative political unity, that was an important landmark. But, you know, it doesn't take away from the fact that 1,000 years ago, when Ramanujacharya wanted an unexpurgated copy of the Brahma Sutras, none was available in peninsular or central India. He had to go all the way to Kashmir, to a small village called Sharda, which is now a ruined village on the other side of the LOC. And there he got a copy of the Brahma Sutras. So from Kanchipuram, the man went there. So this business that somehow only 1778, only census of India, only map of India, as given to us by Clement Attlee and Radcliffe, that is the reality. I think we need to kind of not buy into that. Because that then leads to consequences of very absurd Marxist, postmodernist kind of views of the world, which we have to reject.
Thank you very much. I would suggest perhaps after reading your book, Shanti Parva and Tirukkural must be made compulsory reading in all universities and schools. Neither of it is read today, actually. Very sad, actually, from one angle. 220 years, roughly, the Mughal Empire was there. 12 pages of 8th class history book devotes for it. You ask the student, he will immediately tell, you know, Akbar, Babar, Jahangir, Aurangzeb, like that. 222 years was, believe me, sir, our Hampi, Krishna Devara, so many others and others. One half a paragraph on that. This is how we have comprehensively distorted our own self-image and self-thinking. There is no need, you know, it could be at least 6 pages or so. It just dismissed as if it's nothing.
It's worse than that, Vaidhi. The argument is that Indian thinking is all otherworldly, it's all ascetic, they're all going to Himalayas, living in caves, they're not interested in this world. Now, Shanti Parva and Tirukkural are texts about this world, about individuals living in society in this world. The entire discussion on Rajadharma in Shanti Parva is about political constitutionalism a la Locke. You know, it is in that, it's as good or better than Burke. It's in the same league. And Porulpal and Arathapal in Tirukkural are comprehensive manuals of political discussion comparable to the best we have in the Federalist Papers. So by not teaching that, we are losing. And I think, frankly, we should publicize it around the world that there has been an extraordinary depth in Indian political thinking. Everybody knows that India does yoga and does some om chanting and all that. But do you know that we've had serious political thinkers and discussing political philosophy with the same majesty as the best that you would find on the two sides of the Atlantic among Anglo-Saxon conservatives? And that is a point that I think school children, college children need to know. It is not, and I use this word deliberately, it's not purely an imported intellectual conceit. Whereas Marxism and postmodernism are both bogus imported intellectual conceits.
So thank you very much. I think maybe the time has come to open it to some of the people who may have something to add or some questions to ask.
A question for Jerry. Other than localism, what criteria does Indian conservative thought give us to judge what is worth preserving?
Excellent question. And I think in some sense, why did Ram Mohan not simply argue that Sati was bad? Why did he say that Sati is not approved by the ancient scriptures? Because he said, hey, there's some parts of the ancient scriptures that are worth preserving. I've written a recent piece just a week ago in the print, which I urge you to read, where I've argued that everybody who criticizes Macaulay's legacy and the Raj should read the full text, the 1,000-page text of the Supreme Court's Ayodhya judgment. It is written in stately English prose, comparable to a Lab or a Stern. So Chandrachud obviously is a good prose writer. It uses Latin expressions, res judicata, ultra vires, very casually. It's all about adverse possession, which is an English common law concept not there in continental courts. A juristic person, Ram the deity is a juristic person, came up in the Calcutta High Court, confirmed by the Privy Council during British rule of India. So we should not be criticizing the Raj legacy. There are parts of the Raj legacy that we need to preserve and build on, including eccentric, unpredictable Supreme Court judges who write good English prose. You know, the point is, there are many aspects, and I think we need to be very careful about this. On the social side, there are many aspects that we need to do away with. It is interesting. Both Ambedkar and Rajagopalachari argued that in the long run, the caste system will only go away with intermarriage. Now, Rajagopalachari is the ultimate doyen of Indian conservatism. He said that in a speech he made at SNDT University in Bombay. So yes, I think there are aspects, particularly on the social side, and I think Disraeli understood that. Disraeli, by the way, extended franchise in England. He was warned by his party, saying by extending franchise, conservatives will lose. Actually, they all turned out and became good conservative voters. Margaret Thatcher, she sold all those council houses to the residents. Those residents became conservative voters because now they were homeowners, not renters. And homeowners tend to be conservative. So, you know, there are aspects of the past that we need to preserve. I think particularly today, I am a great proponent of preserving the best aspects of the Raj legacy. And we are not doing enough. Even in this state, I don't think we are doing enough to preserve the legacy of Krishna Rajendra Wadiyar, Mirza Ismail Vishweshwaraya. Because they're all discarded, or they're Maharajas, bad people. This whole vocabulary, and I've mentioned that. In some place, I have quoted the fact that in Indira Gandhi's cabinet, there were some KGB agents. So some of my friends, including my editor, said, "Are you sure about this?" I said, "Just go to YouTube and watch the Mitrokhin diaries." Mitrokhin was a KGB agent who subsequently defected to America, and he has openly said how they suborned and managed agents at the highest levels of Indian political system in the 60s and 70s. So they kind of made this that the British Raj is a bad thing. I think particularly today, we need to be very conscious that the British Raj, in fact, I would say the 200 years between 1750 and 1950, it's one of the finest periods in the history of India from the point of view of cultural efflorescence, from the point of view of extraordinary intellectual achievement. So to keep constantly diss it, constantly put it down is one example, but there are many more that we need. Thirukkural is a good example. Nobody in Northern India has even heard of Thirukkural. We've kind of ignored it. It's a foundational text for our country. It's such an important text, but it's kind of casually shrugged away because it's not part of the religious, otherworldly, Om Shanti, Yoga, Rajneesh view of India. It is actually a very Lockean, Hobbesian, Adam Smithian, Burkean view of India. I don't know if that fully, but there are aspects, but I think we have to go one by one, what we want to preserve and what we don't.
Thank you. The question here, so moving on from the whole preserve piece to the evolve and kind of, you know, keep yourself true, to keep yourself true. So it goes back to the piece where you discuss social and then discuss caste and said that's a difficult topic. The Marxist view will be, hadn't it been for the left and liberal view, caste would have been preserved by the conservatives. So how do you make the entire system self-correcting rather than requiring an external
move? That is completely false. Read Bandarkar's speech, 1895 Indian Social Congress. He is completely opposed to caste. In fact, I've even argued about that. The Marxists only write negative stuff about the Arya Samaj. The Arya Samaj gives equal rights to women. It does not accept caste. Anybody can do their puja, whatever havan that the Arya Samajis do.
A part is Anglo.
I have mentioned that. Dayanand Anglo-Vedic. The middle word is A is Anglo. They are very much open to Western ideas. So, in fact, the opposition to caste or to, not opposition, because that's a strong word, the attempt to evolve caste in a more sensible, meritocratic direction has in fact come from the conservative side, and it's not appreciated enough. Even the Ram Janam Bhoomi movement, many of the fellows who were doing that brick and all were from Dalit castes. And in fact, the first Indian OBC prime minister has come from the Hindu Nationalist Party, not from your communists never had. You read Kanshi Ram on communists. Nambudripa, Jyoti Basu, what's his name, Rana Dive, Chitpavan Brahmins, Nambudri Brahmins, Bhadralok, they were the ones who led the Communist Party. They never gave the break to D. Raja is the first kind of Dalit to get a senior position in the Communist Party. So, you know, it's really the case that conservatives have understood. The entire movement in Maharashtra on widow remarriage, etc., came from very conservative people, Karve, Mandarkar. And so we have to, for that matter, the anti-slavery movement came forth from the transcendentalists in Massachusetts. You know, it didn't come from some Jacobin people, because they would just say, all of you slaves revolt. Which is, then they will, if the slaves revolt, they'll get killed, they'll get massacred. You know, it's not a practical way of freeing the slaves. And finally, England got rid of slavery in the British Empire by compensating the slave owners, actually paying them to take over the slaves who were considered property, and it was successful. So there are ways to do social reform, social change, which are not Jacobin. When you do the Jacobin French revolutionary tradition, you get rid of the good and the bad together. France is yet to recover from 1789, quite frankly. It remains a wounded nation. Yes, sir.
Yeah, one point I'd like to add there, actually. Yeah. All changes come about by people, institutions who are rooted deeply to the culture of the soil. That is very, very important. If you want to reform caste, if you want to reform, you know, various aspects of the thing, you find the people who are very much rooted because they are trusted, not the outsiders, not those stand out and throw stones and say, we should abolish caste. Their credibility is very low. Yeah.
Here. Please bring it here.
Thank you. I think you spoke about the importance of local institutions, which has come down since a long time, the local. We even include institutions like the panchayats or clubs in cities and so on and so forth. Certainly very good. In a political parlance, I'm taking the parallel. Don't you think that decentralization is very important? And what is happening today is that we are witnessing more of centralization, which is creating its own problems. Speak about one nation, one language, one nation, one poll, and things like that. And they're trying to. And, even a lot of state subjects under the Constitution, where powers have to be exercised by the states, or in some way or the other, you know, exercised by the center. You know, central schemes and so many things. So the dominance of the center, I'm not saying this is peculiar now, but even earlier it was prevalent, even in there. But probably it is becoming more and more pronounced. So don't you think? I think there also this concept of decentralization, which we observe on the social side, should get strengthened.
I'll give you two responses to that. The Government of India Act of 1935, which is, in my opinion, one of the finest pieces of legislation to come out of Westminster. Attlee was involved a great deal in writing large sections of it. Talked about provincial autonomy, and in fact, they were called prime ministers of Madras, Bombay, and so on, presidencies, had extensive powers, and those cabinets were very powerful, and central government was quite minimalistic. I think because of the partition thing, there was a lot of fear between 47 and 50. We 1950 constitution is largely, take 70% is a repeat of the Government of India Act of 1935. But those that are not repeats are in fact moving towards centralization, particularly in terms of taxation and fiscal powers, and that's where the real issues are. The second thing is the Montague-Kempsford reforms of 1920 had actually created fairly powerful city governments. My friend Jayaprakash of the Lok Shakti Party, he always tells this story. Rajendra Prasad was president of Patna municipality. Jawaharlal Nehru was president of Allahabad municipality. Vallabhai Patel was president of Ahmedabad municipality. Rajagopalachari was president of Salem municipality. So we were able to get municipal level leaders. But today, you don't even know the name of the mayor of Bangalore, because we have kind of, and every time, you know, poor Rajiv Gandhi, he tried very hard. But the states have refused to really give fiscal powers further down. So Gulbarga to Bangalore is almost like going to a different country. For every decision of Gulbarga to bring it to Vidhan Sabha in Bangalore is a joke. But we've done that, and we continue to, and again, if you look at the way we have redrawn the state maps, the capital of Karnataka is right at the southern end of the state. The capital of Maharashtra is right at the western end of the state. How far it is from Nagpur? Capital of Tamil Nadu is right at the northern end of the state. So we have centralized and we have distorted. We need to do a corrective on this. It's not easy, because constitutional change, as you know, is an extremely delicate and dangerous thing. I lived in Latin America for a few years. There they get rid of the constitution every 10 years and they'll rewrite a whole new constitution. It's been disastrous for them. It has been responsible for their decay as a continent. But yes, we have to try how we go about doing this. I think one thing is, again, Rajiv Gandhi's instincts were good when he tried the 74th or 76th amendment. 74th. But you know, the Indian political class and bureaucracy have various ways of sabotaging these things. I don't think Vidhan Sabha or Mantralay is willing to give powers to a Raichur or to an Akola or Amravati. It's very tough. It's just as Delhi doesn't want to give.
No, it's
to
also
the states.
Political. It's not merely bureaucratic.
It's both. I agree. I mean, it's very tough to get this done. I don't think any chief minister wants a powerful mayor of Bangalore.
That's exactly the point. That's right. But similarly, on the regulatory regime, which Professor touched upon, don't you think now there's more and more of regulation making the lives of ordinary man miserable in the present regime? Do you agree or not?
We're up to me.
Yes.
Of course.
Somebody asked me seriously, since I have been associated with 6-7 regulators actually, almost all of them, RBI, SEBI, name one institution. And somebody asked me, whom do you find, what is the regulator which is? I told, I have an old Crompton fan at home. And that regulator is the one which still.
Yes. One more here, please. Is somebody there?
Yeah.
Please stand up. I can't see.
I wanted to ask you about the Indian conservative and the Indian Muslim. You cited some examples of an intersection of those two particular sets, but mainly in the field of music and mostly in the field of music and art. Though it is quite distressing to see A.R. Rahman's daughter come on Twitter completely clothed in that burqa and the hijab. So, with the rise of Salafism and Wahhabism in India, How do you see the Indian conservative response to that? And is there a future scenario when you see you can be an Indian Muslim and an Indian conservative?
Yeah, a good question. A little bit about the past. I have argued that Sir Syed Ahmad Khan actually was an excellent Indian conservative Muslim. Among other things, he liked British rule. So in my book, anybody who liked British rule is a good guy. The Indian Muslim intellectual, just like the Indian intellectual with his problems, they have their set of problems have been either you are part of the Walilula tradition, which goes back to Sarhindi. Sarhindi actually opposed Akbar, syncretism, 500 years ago, and said we should be more Arabist and more Puritan, or the Darashiko, which is more eclectic, more A.R. Rahman, Kamo Sharif. And essentially, in the Muslim League, the eclectic tradition lost out. And Jinnah, who actually started out as a conservative, ended up becoming a revolutionary Jacobin. And they had this very mediocre faux, I call him a faux Islamic Nietzsche, Iqbal, who propounded this kind of, there was another similar guy in Tamil Nadu, Maraimalai Adigal, also faux intellectual, who did these separatist lenses. In present day times, the reason I am optimistic is you can find a Javed Akhtar come on Indian TV and say, I'm an atheist. Let me tell you, he can't say that in many other countries of the world. You have the Salma writing Tamil poetry and bringing a feminist view to it. In fact, arguably the two countries where you might find this Ram Mohan Roy tradition of dropping some bad features and retaining good features, or the Disraeli and Burke tradition, is likely to start in India and Indonesia. I think these are the two countries where the Muslims can look forward to that gradualist conservative. I am not in favor of some radical stuff. Tomorrow let's change all Muslim law. I think that's not a good idea. It has to be committees. I know committees are boring. It has to be consensus. It has to be slow. But you know, on their own, some Muslim women went to Bombay High Court, and now they're going to Haji Ali Dargah. These things are happening. So I am not, Salafi, Wahhabi stuff worldwide, particularly post 9/11, is definitely worrisome for all of us. But India might, and Indonesia might end up being the outliers for us.
One second. Wait for the mic. Yeah.
Question for Mr. Rao. You refer to the depth and breadth of Indian writing. Why is that no Indian business has actually probably set up a research institution to really get into this and make it available to the larger population?
Yeah, we've had this kind of thing quite a bit. I mean, there's India Book Trust out of Delhi that publishes a book review. They've actually translated a lot of Kannada and Tamil stuff into English and tried to spread it around. You know, there's not a demand. Actually, ultimately, books and movies and all, they're demand-driven. So if I do publish a Kannada translation in English, or, God forbid, in Oriya, I don't think I can sell more than 500 copies of it. This is a demand issue, and we need to address that. Frankly, until Borges and Marquez came along, there was no market for Latin American fiction in the rest of the world. But that changed. Those two events, if you will, changed. Something like that, which is where I think if we made Thirukkural, or at least an abridged version of Thirukkural, compulsory for all 9 standard schools in the country, and for 10 standard schools, a summarized version of Bibek Deb Roy's 8th volume of his Mahabharata translation, Shanti Parva, I think that kind of thing will start getting over time greater interest. But right now it's a demand issue. You can talk to any publisher. It's very difficult to sell these books. It's not that people have not tried. People have tried and are trying even as we speak. There's a lot of attempt to translate Penguin as a series. A lot of people have series of translating. But particularly cross Indian language translations, so you will not be able to sell anything. You try to translate something from Telugu into Assamese. I mean, I don't think even 50 volumes will sell. So it's very difficult to do that. Let's be realistic about it.
So one point I want to mention, the selling of this is also partly, you know, the way in which the government and various institutions are encouraging. For instance, if you take ICSSR, UGC, and various other, every government college is compulsorily have to buy many of these Marxist already, actually.
Correct, that's true.
EPW is a compulsory purchase by all the. Nobody buys it otherwise. The reason is you have to publish in that so that your faculty will appreciate. And it is mutual back scratching. Let me be very blunt about it. You publish there, I will appreciate it. I will quote you 2-3 times. And then you will start quoting me as I quoted you. This whole thing is a. So as long as, you know, let me be. I hope I don't hurt anybody. Hindu sells because of the large pressure from people who feel that for appearing in IAS, you must read Hindu. You go to JNU, people who come from Orissa and Bihar, they all buy Hindu. Why? Because, sir, Hindu may be asked in the IAS. Very simple. So there is a huge government missionary, what you may call, propagating communism in this country. Let me be very blunt about it. There is nothing hide and seek or anything. So if I take this book and say that they should be ICSSR, even today, you look at their 500 research publication. If you have time, go and look at it. All of them are Xerox copy of each other. Naxalism and Hinduism, Marxism and Naxalism. Naxalism, everything has to have an underpinning of what they call Marxist. Marxist method research is accepted as the way of doing research.
And this is true in the US too. Columbia is a hotbed of Marxism. It's just absurd. And the scholars who study India in a Chicago, in a Berkeley, in a Pennsylvania, they will all have a Marxist view. They will talk about Gramsci and hegemonism, and even their vocabulary, Foucault, Derrida, is just amazing. And that's kind of seeped into our academia. He needs a mic.
Hello. Yeah, I have the next question. I raised my hand at the very start.
Okay, go ahead.
Yeah. I just start by saying I think I'm probably the thing that most of all of you here hate. I'm a college student, probably of the left leaning. Just here to ask some questions, you know, clarify some statements, if that's okay. I have some questions and some statements. I hope you can maybe take note or maybe like.
Do keep it short because we're running out of time and we have to give him time.
Yeah, first thing, one of the earliest things that you guys mentioned was a Nehruvian Stalinist way of thinking. I'd like to question how Nehru and Stalin, according to you, are in the similar bracket of thinking, considering that Nehru was a social democrat. Considering that Nehru was a social democrat with, you know, slightly socialist economic policies, whereas Stalin was a Marxist-Leninist who did not believe in the same democratic principles and had a very different view of the economy, with the only similarity, according to me at least, being that they followed a 5-year plan. I'd like you to kind of elaborate on what makes Nehru and Stalin the same. Second, you keep mentioning continuously about academia being infiltrated by Marxists and so on. My question to you is that maybe it's just the fact that when people educate themselves, they tend to realize that that left way of thinking might be the accurate way of thinking, and that there might not be some grand conspiracy theory that, you know, people have infiltrated academia with Marxism. You know, it might just be that that ends up being the right way of thinking.
I think we'll stop there because we do have to go to other.
Sure.
But I'm happy to respond to both of them. When we talk about the similarity between 1950s India and the Stalinist way of thinking, it really is about gigantism. It is about having a Yojana Bhavan, which is the same as a Ghost plan in Moscow, which will tell every Indian factory in every part of the country, what to produce, how much to produce, when to produce. It is about building massive dams, very similar to the ones that the Soviet Union built. It is about building, you know, total cities of anomie like Chandigarh. So there is obviously not an identity, but there is clearly a Stalinist inspiration to the India, particularly post-Avadi, right up until, I would say, Indira Gandhi's second term, right up until 1980. So 58 to 18, almost a 25-year period. In fact, it is interesting, there is a Hindi poet called Sumitra Nandan Pant. I don't know how many of you have read him. My aunt has read him. The Soviets, Mitrokhin talks about it. They have taken 30 Indian writers to Moscow where they keep drinking vodka and getting sozzled. And this man writes a panegyric to Stalin. So it was not uncommon. The royalties that some of these fellow traveler writers would get from Mir publishers in Moscow of the Russian translations of their Indian works would be far in excess, would be 10x, 15x of the royalties they would get from the Hindi or Bengali versions they wrote here. So it was also a very deliberate strategy, as was CIA's in terms of infiltrating India. So this is not something, but there is a correlation between Nehruvian central planning and the accoutrements of it and the way the Stalinists thought. They didn't run gulags, but you know, they wanted to do collective farming. I mentioned that in my book. Collective farming would have come to India and 20 million people would have died, like they died in the famines in China and Soviet Union, except the Swatantra Party had one caucus member within the Congress Party, Charan Singh, stopped it. Otherwise, Nehru and Malanobis was very keen to push through collective farming in India, and we know what happened with collective farming in the Ukraine, and we know what happened with it in China. Your second question is, yes, there has been a strategy of infiltration. And at least in India, he mentioned, this is not hidden. Nurul Hasan said it. He said, I'm going to do this, and he did it. He was Minister of Education under Indira Gandhi, and at a time when Indira Gandhi had several Marxists, Kumar Mangalam, Wadud Khan, this, that, several Marxists around her, Dinesh Singh, all these fellows, the D.P. Dhar, they forced this idea through that they created NCERT. NCERT was created at that time. Why do we need you're talking about decentralization. Why can't we have textbooks in every state? Why do we need a National Council of Educational Research and Training? And all of those historians, all of those writers are Marxists. So that's a way to give them a living also. And it's been done fairly deliberately. In America, I think it's been more insidious. Post-1968, after Berkeley and Paris, essentially, and in fact, the person who publicized Foucault in America was an Indian, Gayatri Spivak, first translated Foucault into English. And with, no? Derrida, I'm sorry, Derrida. You know, the terrible influence of Foucault and Derrida and Althusser and all these bizarre fellows from the continent actually destroyed Anglo-Saxon scholarship, which had a different tradition altogether. You know, you can't today talk to an English literature student and talk about Bradley or Tilliard. You can't. Everything has to be feminist, non-hegemonic. Everything is about looking at stuff from subaltern stuff. Hey, you know, that way the Gospel of Mark is also subaltern, but it's glorious English literature. There is this problem. It has happened. It is not because Marxism is a superior idea. It's not. It's a failed idea. Nobody tried to migrate from West Germany to East Germany. Everybody in East Germany wanted to come to West. Nobody from South Korea wants to go North. everybody from north comes. So the Marxism is a completely failed ideology. They had to do a wall. Normally you build a wall to keep people out. They had to build a wall to keep people in. It's gone. And not accepting it and kind of rephrasing it in cultural terms. Now it's no longer economic Marxism, because that we know has failed. It's all this cultural stuff, feminism, trans, more and more extreme statements. In fact, 9/11, when it happened, about 2 weeks later, I was talking to this American friend of mine, and I said, you just watch it. Every single leftist professor is going to become a lover of Islam. Not because they like Islam, but because some Muslims have attacked World Trade Center. Anything which is anti-capitalist, anti-American, anti-Western, the leftists have to support. You know, it's a bizarre situation. And we just have to keep fighting it. Because just because they have captured the citadels of power doesn't mean they're going to have it ever. The self-goal that people like BJP play is by putting some fellow who says Ramayana is history and all as professor. That makes the opponents of Marxism look foolish. That's not a clever strategy. We have to find the right people. It's very difficult, but we have to find them. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Just 1 second, sir.
Yeah, I think so.
One question here.
Yes, sir.
No, I think he has been waiting for
Yes, sir. Sir, as a student who studied along with Mr. Professor Vaidyanathan in the school, Ramakrishna School, we have some problem with Thirukkural. Thirukkural was put in all buses in those days. We were all traveling by the same bus to the college and schools and all that. But it did not have much impact because it is very prescriptive. You do this, you do this, you do this. You don't do this, you don't do this. That is why it has become very unpopular. In fact, today, all my children are outside India, and I cannot tell them that, look, you read Thirukkural every day. It is not possible. It is like saying to my son in USA that don't wear jeans and go to the temple. He said, that is the only cloth I have, because he is working in a software company. So therefore, these are all very difficult things to implement. Sorry that I disagree with you on that. That is one. Sir, as a teacher, forget about it. As a teacher, both of you are teachers. Can we penetrate and rewrite the history all in a quick fix just to tell everybody that, look, this is the history which we should learn, whether we can do it faster? That is the only point.
Conservatives are opposed to doing anything fast. It has to be a slow process if it has to be successful. Anything you do fast radically will boomerang. We'll come to you, sir, and then we'll stop. Sure. Don't worry. I think history fixing is a long process. We just don't have scholars of repute on our side. They have occupied all the scholarship positions. As I said, if today somebody in an American university says, why don't you read a little bit of Gibbon or Toynbee, they'll laugh at him. The only thing you can read is subaltern Honduran history or something. Honduras is a perfectly okay place. But for God's sake, Gibbon is important. Decline and fall of Rome is central to the history of humanity. But that has become the problem, and we need to figure out a way how we get back in there. Now, Thirukkural, you're absolutely right. I think if it is simply put out as La Rochefoucauld's maxims, which is what many of the Kurals sound like, it becomes boring. But I think if somebody were to take, maybe I'll give a shot at this. This is my next book. Take a shot at working around the spirit. The man, the plowman is the only one who really lives. The rest of us are like idle camp followers. Now, the spirit of enterprise, the spirit of economic activity, that only the producer is worth respecting, you know, not the king who's taxing and taking away taxes from the producer. I think if somebody did a way to kind of annotate and put it out, there will be great, good reception to it. That's the way I would say. Yes, sir, we'll take that, and we have to close.
Yeah, so we have the conservatives on one hand and the liberals on the other hand. But with the way the liberals and the leftists have been going on in the recent past, be it in America or recently concluded the British election, Do you really think the definitions of a conservative and liberal still stand today, as in the classical sense?
There is no classical definition. It's all 200 years. It's all happened since Locke and Hobbes. Are Locke and Hobbes liberals? The liberals will claim them. Are they conservative? So definitively, we only start with Burke, who called himself a conservative and who his opponents call a conservative. So it's a very recent thing. Is Hamilton a conservative? He fought a revolutionary war against his rulers. Yeah. Hamilton was a colonel in George Washington's army. So, and I've got 3-4 pages about Gandhi and Ambedkar, whether they're conservatives or not. So I think the thing to do is to stop worrying too much about the labeling, but to look at what is the underlying importance of Burke, Smith, Hume, Hamilton in terms of the intellectual content they have left us, the importance of Ramon Roy, all the way down to Masani, Bunkim, all the way to Dindayal. Dindayal is very interesting. There's no word Hindu at all. He talks about integral humanism. There is no, he doesn't even talk about Hinduism. It's very, very interesting. So I think let us pay attention to these intellectual movements and let us give them back the respectability and respect that they deserve, that they have been denied, at least since Nur al Hasan's time. And see, in that process, can we create a greater dialogue? It's not going to be easy, let me tell you, because there are no PhDs in anthropology, sociology, history, even English literature, who don't subscribe to Marxist or Freudian. Look at Divinity School. Kirpal's book on Ramakrishna Paramahamsa is basically Freudian. That he got a PhD in an American university for it, for saying Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was a homosexual who was having it out with his disciples. This is considered a PhD thesis and a published book. It's a very Freudian interpretation. I'm not, you know, it's allowable, but if you have a class of 25 students and 24 of them are brainwashed into believing this, that everything about Indian culture can be looked at through the lens of Freud, who's a discredited fellow. In modern neuroscience, Freud is considered a joke. He's a discredited fellow, and yet Ganesha-Parvati relationship is about Oedipus complex. Yashoda-Krishna relationship is about suppressed incest. Where do we go? It's very tough, because they're very clever. Wendy Doniger has read more Sanskrit than all of us put together in this room. They're scholars. They're not. But they come with a certain view. Caldwell was quite a scholar, but he came with a view. He wanted to encourage conversion to Christianity among certain lower caste Tamilians. So he wanted to tell them, you're a different race. Today, DNA studies shows there is no separate race. But at that time, he got away with it. And the consequences of what he did stay with us today with the Dravidian political movement. So we need to, I'm saying, there's no quick fixes. That's the thing to understand. We have to start the talk. We have to start the dialogue. And we have to keep going away. Conservatives don't like a quick fix. No revolutions, only evolution. Many committee meetings, many discussions, many draft reports, continuous dialogue, and that leads you somewhere. Thank you.
So thank you, Jerry Rao. And last but not the least is, kindly buy his book. You have many more questions, I'm sure, which are not answered. And there are some people who have what one can call unasked for answers also in the audience. So you buy the book, go through that, it will give you clarity. You must read the book, and maybe twice, right? I would say. Kindly buy the book. It's a book of 2019, non-fiction. Thank you.